flute, in my case, back in kindergarten days, I think. This musical early instruction, is it
education? That? Yeah, I don't know what it's called, actually.
Children education, you know, it was like this typical flute thingy that I learned, and those little xylophone type of things.
Chime bells or something?
I have no idea what they're called in English.
Yeah.
Glockenspiel.
Yeah.
For the German-speaking people. We can do it in subtitles.
Like, okay, like a small xylophone.
Cool. Yeah. And that was the first stuff that I learned back then.
Same with me, actually. Yeah. I started the same way, and then I started building my own drum kits.
Cooking pots.
Yeah, cooking pots. And yeah, very fancy creations there. But the first instrument to learn, like from a teacher, was definitely the flute.
Yeah.
The early music education.
In my case, when I was around like 10, 11 years old, my parents wanted me to properly learn an instrument, so flute and the stuff from back then didn't count anymore. And they were suggesting me things that they like clarinet and stuff like that, which I had no interest at all. And that was around the time when I started discovering music for myself. And the songs that I wasn't focused on bands yet, but there were a couple of songs that really, you know, made it for me. That was like Pink Floyd, Another Brick in the Wall, and Sultans of Swing by the Dire Straits and stuff like that. And I realized, okay, that's guitars. So I want to learn guitar. And I told my parents that they should forget about the clarinet and that I wanted to learn how to play guitar. So they enlisted me in Krefeld's music school, and I had classical concert guitar education for a couple of years, like 5-6 years, learning all the basics. And at the same time, or a year or two after that, I got into metal and started learning Black Sabbath riffs on my Spanish acoustic guitar. And at some point I said, okay, that's enough with the basics, I want an electric guitar, and continued like that.
Yeah, I started learning how to drum when I came to middle school, which is about age of 9 or 10. And I joined the school big band, first as a percussionist, and then when the older drummer became obsolete, I replaced him. Player took his seat over. And then I started by age of 10, I started learning, taking drum lessons, which were basically all around, also like all kind of styles, and had already my passion for rock and metal music when I was, let's say, age of 12. And I started listening to Blind Guardian back then.
Good choice.
Yeah, it proved to be the right choice. And yeah, then I figured that I want to do that for my living, and started preparing for studying music in jazz and popular music, which I finished 2004, and then 2005 I joined Blind Guardian. And yeah, meanwhile played a little piano and learned bagpipes and little extra instruments, but basically my instrument is drums, and that's where I feel the most comfortable with.
My very first guitar, I still own it. Yeah, it was that classical guitar that I played when I was going to that music school. It was some Yamaha whatever model. I guess it was cheap back then, because I doubt you start on an expensive one. But I still have it. You know, it's not that I played a lot, but it's sitting there, and it's just the first guitar I ever had. So that's always something special. And the first electric guitar actually was a copy of the Michael Schenker Flying V, that black and white Flying V when the colors on the pickup were reversed. It was some cheap thing, I forgot the name of the company, El Hondo or something, you know, it was like some cheap thingy, but it looked like the real thing, and it had a set neck, so it was not bolt-on neck or anything, and I played it for a couple of years, and that, you know, I've been a Schenker fan, so that's the reason why I wanted that guitar. And it worked, it did the job. And I don't have that one anymore, unfortunately.
I do remember my first drum kit, and I got it from my parents, and had it for a couple of years, maybe 2 to 3 years. It was a black new sound. And so I didn't mind the sound of it, I just needed an instrument to practice on. And then when I developed a certain taste for the drum sound, then I started getting into, a Sonor. That was the first I chose myself. And then when I earned a little money, saved all my money together, and I bought my own very first drum kit. I think it was a Mapex. And then I changed to Tama, and then became, of course, a big fan, and ever since only the Tama kits anymore. But yeah, it was kind of development to there.
Guilty as charged. I own about 30 something guitars. I would have to count, I'm not exactly sure, but it's not that I collect guitars for the sake of having them. So when I see that I don't play a certain model for 2 years or whatever, that I don't touch it, then I just get rid of it, because that proves to me that this is a guitar that I don't really need. And as I said, I don't just keep guitars underneath the bed just for the sake of having one more. But as I said, I have around 30 in the moment, and I think it's the same for most guitar players. You know, at some point, the very last thing I need is another guitar, but the very first thing that I want is another guitar. Like when we came here and I saw that one, I was like, hello. And you know, you just keep running into instruments that like wave to you, smile to you and say, pick me up, and I'm sure my collection will still grow. And on the same time, I know that at some point, most likely, I will get rid of a couple of ones that I have now. If I stop playing them, as I said, I'm open to sell them and make room for others.
Yeah, for drums, it's not as easy to collect different drum kits because they need more space. As Marcus said, I also have what I need. Basically, so if I'm in need of a new drum kit for a special function, since I'm teaching too, and sometimes I need like an extra drum kit in different category as like a metal kit, of course I get something. But yeah, I mean, I have a variety of snares to choose from, and like every now and then I try a different model and experiment with the sound a little bit. Different drum heads are sometimes interesting to experiment with. Also cymbals, of course, but like the main, if you call the main instrument the whole kit, I'm very happy with what I have, and I get so much nice stuff with the companies that support me, and I'm very, very happy with that. So for the last tour I was thinking of maybe having for the new stage presence a new kit, and then I was like, actually, I'm very happy with what I have. Why should I start creating new things just because for the different color or something? It's, if I'm happy with the sound, how can I get better from there? So,
because
actually, yeah, if you have a working instrument and a working setup, you would not change it.
There was a guitar. I don't have it anymore. Actually, I donated it to the Hard Rock Cafe in Hamburg. That was the guitar that we used for the Bard Song, an old ovation of mine. And so, I mean, the Bard Song is a pretty iconic song in our history. So that guitar is kind of linked to that. But other than that, there's one guitar that really means a lot to me. It's not really tied to the history of Blind Guardian. It's the first Gibson Les Paul that I bought. So I think it was in 90, 96, 97, something like that, a Black Beauty Les Paul custom. And that just got me hooked completely. It has been, from that day on, my favorite guitar, and is still, to the day, my main and favorite guitar. Wherever we go, I always have that guitar with me. And so that's very special to me, just because it's the perfect guitar for me. It's just standard, there are nobody, I think I changed pickups at some point. But otherwise, it's just a standard Les Paul custom, and I wouldn't know what to change about it, because that could have been my signature model. You know, everything is exactly how I wanted it to be. That just makes it very special. Looks great, sounds great, feels perfect for me. There are a couple of things that I don't own in the moment that I want to buy. Most of my guitars are Gibsons. I'm a huge Gibson fan, played Les Pauls for the last 25 years almost exclusively. But over the years, especially in the recent couple of years, I expanded a bit, also playing different shapes. Also mainly Gibson, like bought an Explorer, Flying V and an SG and stuff like that. But there are a couple of guitars that always attracted me, like Paul Reed Smith. Just have some beautiful instruments, and I definitely want to buy a custom 22 or maybe custom 24 at some point, just because I really, really like that guitar. I want to buy a Strat at some point, because you know the position of the volume control is something that drives me completely nuts, because if I would play regular Blind Guardian stuff on it, it would take like 10 seconds and it would be rolled off, because I would completely hit it all the time with my right hand. But it just, you know, it's a beautiful guitar, it's an iconic guitar, and you know, it just, especially for clean sound, it sounds amazing, and you can get sounds out of a Strat that you can't really get with a Les Paul, just as there are Les Paul sounds that you can't get with a Strat. So I like having some of these. I mean, obviously, I guess every guitar player dreams about owning a like original 59 Les Paul, which, if you're not Joe Bonamassa, nobody can afford. So that would stay a dream. But you know, those would be kind of guitars that I definitely plan to buy in the not too distant future. And you know, just for the sake of loving them and wanting to have one at least.
I have also two guitars.
One is mine.
One is yours. And I actually bought one here in that store. Tolman. I bought a Harley Benton half acoustic, because I always like to just grab a guitar and play and not like plug and set my amplification system up and stuff like that. So just sit on the couch or in front of a fireplace or whatever. Yeah, I know it's very stereotype, but
that's fine.
Just like play a little chords and
that's fine. Like nothing wrong
getting
with
into
that.
Getting into the topic. It's a Thomas Duck Classic Bubinga Birch mix, and it has two bass drums. Who's surprised? 22 inch. And then I have only the even sizes for the toms, like 8, 10, 12, 14, 16, 18, like two floor toms on actually both sides. Then we have an axis in the middle of my drum kit, and then I have everything mirrored and can use both sides kind of equally. I use basically, all cymbals are Meinl. Basically the MB20 series, which is my favorite one, and then just as a little addition, I have some Bisons for a little lighter accents and some splashes that are maybe, like one is also MB20, and some percussion additions. Then I use for a snare drum, what do I use right now? It's like the Warlord. It's a Bubinga Warlord. Very nice, beautiful snare, and has also the Bubinga wood, which supports a very nice impact and has that this kind of metal tone by itself, even though it's not a metal snare, but metal is a music style. What else? The drum heads are Evans For the toms, I'm definitely a fan of the EC2, which has like the built-in muffle ring, or like focusing the tone that you don't have to damp that much anymore. So you just put the skin on or drum head on, and it sounds the way you want it right away without tuning so much. And also the resonant heads from underneath is also the EC resonance. So I can recommend that for anyone who wants to have an easy solution. Just put the EC resonance and the EC2 on top and they work perfectly together. Drum head on the snare is a EC1, so it matches kind of the characteristica of the toms. And the bass drums are EQ4 coded, which is a little surprising, but it maintains a kind of shorter sound and more control, because you have, of course, damping material in the bass drums themselves. Sticks are a German, very small company called iStix, and I like them for their durability. Best sticks I ever had in my hands, and ever since I had them the first time, I didn't want to change anymore. So that's something I really can recommend also for long-lasting, very nice balanced sticks. This is my current setup, I think.
For me, starting with guitars, it's mainly Gibson. There's a rotation, you know, and we have 10 guitars with us in the moment, and I just rotate them from time to time, change them. In the moment, it's two Les Paul Customs, it's two Les Paul Traditionals, it's a Flying V, an Explorer, a 7-string Les Paul Classic, and then there's three non-Gibson guitars. There's two Epiphones, actually, two Epiphone SST Studios, which I use for the acoustics, because the brilliant thing is it's solid body guitar with a piezo pickup that just sounds brilliant and you don't run into feedback problems. And obviously if you have a regular acoustic guitar, normally back in the days I used my J45 Gibson, which sounds beautifully, but in heavy metal gig volume you might run into problems, and you know, it starts humming and beeping and feedbacking. So with the Epiphones that Gibson gave me, that was solved immediately. And the other non-Gibson guitar is a Schecter Hellraiser Hybrid C7 7-string guitar, which has one big advantage. I have two Gibson 7-strings as well, that 7-string classic that I have with me, and also one of those SGs, the Dark 7 or whatever they are called. The Schecter has the big advantage of having a longer scale, and especially for those low tunings, the short Gibson scale, the much I love it for 6-strings, it can be a problem on the 7-strings, because, you know, intonation gets tricky at some point. So I wanted to have a guitar with a longer scale, so I bought one at Thomann. Amplifier-wise, I'm normally a Mesa Boogie guy and play triple rectifiers with recto caps. But live, I completely switched to Fractal Audio XFX XLs, because it's just the easiest solution you can use live. You know, I plug in two cables, I'm good to go. I don't need sound checks, because all my sounds are pre-programmed and I sound the same every day, and my whole rig is in two racks, and you don't have to carry cabinets and heavy amplifiers and stuff like that. You don't have to worry about tubes or anything. And I just programmed my sounds into the XFXs, and what I did is, like, I normally need like 5 presets to get me through the show, and I programmed these with different amplifiers. So I have the whole setup with a virtual rectifier, with the virtual Mark IV, with the 2C Plus, and also with Friedman Brown Eye. So whatever I'm in the mood for, I can just use this bank. If I say I'm in Mark IV mode today, I just switch to that bank and I'm good to go. And if I want the rectifier again, I just hit one button on my pedal board and I'm on the rectifier again. Strings are D'Addario. Always used them, always loved them. My straps are from Richter straps. I have a signature strap from them. That's very nice. Picks, is Dunlop, the Jazz 3. I always like those small, very pointy picks, because the bigger the pick, the kind of slower I get it. I don't know, you have to move too much. there can be. Live is exactly the setup that I just described. For recording, I don't really care what's there. I mean, if you're in the studio, you don't have to worry about weight and transporting it from A to B. You have your setup there. And the only thing that matters for me in the studio is the sound. I want to get the sound that I have in my head or that we need for a certain part or song or whatever. And whatever does the job there is fine. I don't really care if it's one of my boogies or if it's an XFX or if it's anything else. You know, as long as it sounds right and that's the sound that I want, I'm fine with that. And live, I prefer that setup that I just described because it's just very fail-safe and a simple setup. I never liked these huge rack systems with I don't know how many effect things in there, because the more you carry with you, the more can go wrong, especially in a live situation. You don't want that, you know. You want something that you switch on and you're good to go and that's reliable. So live, I definitely want a simple, effective, great sounding setup, and in the studio I want to achieve something, and whatever does the job is fine for me.
Yeah, I don't have a major change for the recording situation. I just have a different drum kit for, it's a pure Bubinga one. It's also a Stark Classic Bubinga then. I used to have that one on tour as well, but now it kind of got too valuable for me to be like carried around all the time, and I was a little scared that it could get damaged or something, so I keep that one, my sacred drum kit, I keep that in the studio, and just use my other one, the Bubinga Birch, what I actually have for live situations. The cymbals are kind of the same, and the setup and the whole rack system is the same, so actually I just replace the drum shells and then I'm good to record. So that's, yeah, I mean, it's quite kind of natural, I think, to have the same environment. You record and then you play live. So not having too many changes there. Of course, I don't know that much about other bands, how it works there. But I have, of course, made some experiences with my smaller bands I played for. And I was actually surprised how cool and down-to-earth the guys from my new band, which is also like 11 years now.
You will always stay the new guy.
Yeah, I'm
always unless we change somebody else, that's your job forever.
But I was actually surprised how down-to-earth they all where and still are, and that actually the dynamics are still the same as in my let's say high school bands before, and so this was not that big of a change. Of course, the venues are bigger, the music is bigger, the production is bigger, also the recordings. That was maybe the most part that was different to me, that we had like so many. Let's say that we had so much time to prepare for the studio and the recordings. Not like you have to record 3 or 4 songs a day. So like, take the time you need to record the song properly, but then of course it must be in the end 100%, maybe sometimes 110%. And I liked the challenge, and I liked the professionalism of the production. And it also reflects in the live setup. We want everything to have a backup situation. If something goes wrong, that we're not lost, and that every night we can provide a working show. And for the dynamics, as I said, there's not that big of a change. So I'm very happy with my new people. Cheerful laughter, we're lost in barren land.
I can play bass. I mean, most I can play some basic bass. Yeah. So if I do demos at home, I could record a bass. But you know, I think I managed to keep a very simple beat on drums. But I definitely wouldn't call me a drummer or anything. That's pretty much it in my case.
Okay. I have the same with the guitars. So I just kind of some years ago I got interested in learning a little bit guitar, and yeah, since I'm surrounded by guitarists, I of course ask every now and then a question, give me some tips, what to practice, and I'm just kind of busy with learning the chords, and I mean the chords are there, but like just the matter of what's it called, the grip.
Changing chords.
Yeah, changing chords. Like, yeah, just like a clear, have a clear tone and stuff. So I definitely enjoy that instrument. I learned to play the piano, which I needed for my studying, of course. So it's more like a jazzy pop piano, not very metal. Whatever is a metal piano, by the way. Yeah. So that means also like keyboards. So at home I can use, when I, for instance, come up with some guitar ideas, I usually hack them into my keyboard and have like a guitar simulation for the keyboard, which I can use for presenting ideas for a guitar, because I'm definitely better on a keyboard than on guitar.
Whatever does the job.
At the speed that we need. So then, what I said, like I still play the flutes since I used to play in a medieval band. Also learned, therefore I learned how to play the bagpipes, which is pretty comparable to the flute. And I have a very special secret instrument that hardly ever anyone knows.
Confess.
Shall I confess now?
Yes.
It's a theremin. And whoever knows what a theremin is, it's like those, it's like more like a physics instrument. You have like two rods, antennas.
That thing that makes strange noises when
exactly.
You
go, oh, okay. And you have like your hand positions that you, you get your knuckles out and stuff like that, and you change the pitch by that.
That's
and like one half for the dynamics, it's called theremin.
I've seen that, I think, in It Might Get Loud, that movie. I think that's when they play around with that thing in the end. It's like it doesn't have strings, but it's a lot of fun. So.
It is fun, and it's very actually very cool to have a kind of relaxed, kind of meditative practice session, because it's like very, it's a very musical instrument for feeling music and
one?
Melodies. I have one, yeah.
I come practice. Over next week.
Sure. Yeah, see, that's very secret. I hardly ever tell anyone that. But yeah, so
cool.
That's very, very nice. And it's a very, very special instrument to play and practice. But of course, I have no connection for my professional music ship. To apply. It's just something for myself and for enjoying music.
Sounds like fun.
It's like a very, as I said, very melodic, and it's good practice for your ears, for your melodical thinking and hearing.
Cool.
It's very nice to play. But takes a long time to practice, a long time to see a progress and to get like a good pitch.
Obviously, I'm practicing things. Then, you know, obviously before a tour, when we talk about what songs we will play, you go through them, and sometimes if there are tricky parts, you practice the technique, whatever you might need for that. But something that I like doing is also forcing myself out of my comfort zone, because what most guitarists or musicians, I guess, do is you rely on certain patterns that you like playing, that you're comfortable with. It might be certain chord changes or like pentatonic scales or whatever. So in the moment I'm messing around a lot with different tunings, which force you out of that comfort zone, because whatever you are used to playing, if the guitar is in some open tuning, it doesn't work anymore. And that is kind of relearning your instrument in a certain way, but it opens up a lot of new things that normally you would not be playing, and it kind of changes your view on certain things. And I like doing this. I have a lot of fun with that in the moment. I started with just, you know, regular drop D tuning, which changes things a bit, opens up certain possibilities that are not there normally. Then from drop D, I went to drop C, which is just one full step lower, but it sounded funny. And then I went to some open tunings, and it's just fun. And also, at some point, I was playing around with an 8-string acoustic guitar, which was a real challenge for me, and I failed because my hands were just too small. And I just couldn't, the neck was way too thick for me. I love the idea of having that 8-string thingy there. I don't really know if I would like one as an electric guitar, but for an acoustic guitar it was something really special to me. But I had to accept, you know, I couldn't get to the point where I was playing fluently on that. I always had to fight my way through songs, and it just felt wrong at some point. So I thought, okay, maybe 8-string acoustic guitars is not my thing. Both?
Either or.
Now, I mean, I like both. I, as I said before, I started on acoustic guitar, but I think mainly I play electric guitar. But there's always been acoustic stuff in Blind Guardian's music going on, whether it was the Bard song or Lord of the Rings or Past and Future Secret or whatever. And I like playing both, so I wouldn't like to exclude one of them out of my vocabulary. You know, it's just whatever the part or whatever a song needs. And even if it's a heavy song, if it has some acoustic interlude sections or whatever, that's a fine thing. So definitely both for me.
Yeah, I make it short because it's an either or question. I agree on everything you said. If I have to choose one, I would say plug. Because okay. It's just definitely the sound I like better. And but it doesn't mean that I don't like the other one. And if I have to pick, I would say plug. Nightliner. Period.
Yeah, that's a hard question. Nightliner in general, yes. I prefer being on the road in a nightliner because you always have the opportunity. If you're tired, you go to the bus, there's your bed, you can lie down, you can have a nap, whatever. And if you're on hotels, then it means you most likely will be flying or whatever. You have to get up early, have to be at the airport 2 hours before the show, before the flight, and it just sucks because you lose a lot of time like this because you constantly have to be somewhere or go somewhere. On the other hand, there's something that a nightliner does not offer, and that's privacy. So, you know, on day offs, we normally go to the hotel, and that's something that is important on the road, you know, to have those moments where you can just close the door behind you and have, you know, some privacy and don't see anybody if you don't feel like seeing anybody. Just have a bed that doesn't shake all night. And but yeah, in general, nightliner.
Yeah, for me the uninterrupted sleep weighs more.
That doesn't work for me.
Yeah, definitely. Like, I don't like getting to the hotel at 2 at night and then having to leave at 5 again. Excuse me, that's not very helpful for me.
True.
For my sleep cycles and everything. So I need my energy back, and then I'd rather go to bed whenever I want and then get up and have an uninterrupted sleep of some 8 hours or something.
Yep.
Definitely more valuable to me.
In-ear. All the way.
I agree.
Life.
How long is the time I have to decide? It's a tough decision for me. I definitely like both. If I have to put choose something, I would also go for life then. It's like the pure direct energy you exchange and you get the direct reaction. I go for life, even though I like the perfectionism to work in the studio for the last detail, for the last percent of your tone and everything. I like that too, and you have time and things come to a very nice end, while life you have to live with the situation that is there. So, but yeah, for the energy, life.
I would, you know, both are great, but I would choose the smaller gigs because the problem or something that I really dislike about the big festivals, I mean, obviously you have big stages, if you're headlining, you can do production-wise whatever you want, and that's all great. But something that I'm missing on those gigs is this direct contact to the audience. For example, when we play Wacken, the first row is like 30 meters away from the stage, and you know, it is, obviously you still see people going nuts, but it's something different if there's like the average normal 1 meter photo pit and then there's this wall of people going nuts. So this direct thing is something that I really, really like, and that's why I would pick club gig.
It's true, I agree. I would still go for open air since I'm such a open air fan, like being outside of buildings. And I like that, and especially when I'm playing, I get really hot, so it's definitely an advantage for me to be in the cool air of an open air festival. And I just like the whole atmosphere, and yeah, same with the club gigs, but I have to choose, so I'll go for open air.
For me, CD, definitely. I mean, obviously, when I started with music, it was vinyl. There was no CDs yet. And vinyl had a certain magic about it, like the cover artwork, you know, the size of it. That's something that CD never could get even close to. And if you had covers that you could flip open and stuff, that was pure magic. But I have to say, you know, comfort-wise, you know, CD is so much better, and you know, you can't take vinyl on the road, you know. I mean, obviously people like us, we're traveling so much, and you know, what do I do with vinyl? It stays home and I can't listen to it anyway. So I'm definitely a CD person, and at some point I don't have a record player anymore, so I sold my vinyl at some point. And now there is this, they call it comeback of vinyl, and I see a lot of people starting to buy vinyl again. I don't even think about this because, you know, I have a huge CD collection, and when we're on the road, I put that stuff on my phone. I like have a 200 gigabyte memory card in my phone with all my music stuff on there, and that's more important to me that I have always access to my music because I constantly listen to music, and I want to be able to do it in the nightliner, in the hotel, backstage, wherever I want. And vinyl just doesn't give me that option. So definitely CD.
Yeah, I agree for basically the same reasons. I would also go for CD. I just in the past, when I was of course younger, when vinyl was for everyone a big thing still, I just had like the big bad experience with the records themselves getting damaged very easily.
Scratchy,
if you don't really take care and handle them with care. And for a child or teenager, it was pretty hard to do that. So I definitely saw the advantage of the CD and then having digital copies of the same quality and being just more flexible with what you have. So I'll definitely go for CD.
Star Wars. And you expected something different. No, for me, Star Wars. I mean, I'm of that generation when Star Wars came out. I've seen the first one in the cinema when I was like 9 years old, I think, and it just completely blew me away. And I got hooked immediately. And back then, when you know, adults were asking me, well, what do you want to do professionally later when you grow up? My answer was Jedi Knight. And I'm just, you know, I love Lord of the Rings, I love the books, Tolkien did great things, but I'm just a Star Wars kid. So that, you know, is implanted in my brain, the Force is with me.
I think it's very hard to compare those two brands or those two stories. I would maybe wind up a little bit and say, if I compare science fiction to fantasy, I would go for fantasy. So then in the end, coming back to the original question, I would say Lord of the Rings, because I'm a big fantasy fan.
Me too, I'm just, you know.
Yeah, I know, don't have to explain yourself.
Good, then I don't.
When can we expect the release of the Star Wars records?
The Star Wars records? Hansi? Hansi would have to write the fitting lyrics, then we can do one. keep supporting music and, you know, go to the shows of your favorite bands, buy their albums, and, you know, don't stop, because music is vital, in my opinion.
Yeah, if I might add, if you're not playing an instrument right now,
learn one.
Yeah, choose an instrument that maybe matches you, or you maybe are interested in, and give it a try, because it's very, very much fun to play music actively, not only listen to it. And there's definitely an experience that you should not miss, and at least have given it a chance of trying.
Yeah, and very important, when you come to a gig, it doesn't have to be a Blind Guardian show, whatever band you watch live, keep your fucking phone in your pockets and, you know, watch it with your own eyes. It's 3D, it's, you know, 4K, whatever. It's, you don't need a phone in your hand. Thank you.